So, yeah, for today's talk, I'm going to try to focus as much as I can on the masks, but to like understand like where the masks came from and like what I'm about, I will like go in a bit of an intro that like led to the masks, and then I will tell you a bit about what I'm doing today. So yeah, we are now here in Reykjavik, Iceland, in my studio that I've just moved into. And it's, yeah, downtown, and it's an afternoon here in Iceland. So I'm pretty far away and in different time zones. I hope we had a nice morning. I'm gonna, yeah, go through my work. And then you can see here on this picture, this is the mask that the Museum of International Folk Art purchased from me. And I'll just start with telling you a little bit about myself. My name is Ýr Jóhannsdóttir, is how you pronounce it in Icelandic. And I have an artist name that is Írurari. And I've been working under that name for around 10 years now. And I am a textile artist and designer, but I did study textile design at the Reykjavik School of Visual Arts. And then I finished my BA in Glasgow School of Art. And I'm currently finishing my art education master at Iceland University of the Arts. But I have been a knitter since 1999, because in Iceland we learn how to knit when we are in school. So it's part of the curriculum of children's school in Iceland. When you start third grade, you start textile classes, and they are mandatory until eighth grade. So when I was in third grade, I learned how to knit, and I got very obsessed with knitting. And like you can see on the picture on the left, I used to knit and read books and comics while I was knitting. I don't know how I did it, because I can't do it today. Now I just listen to podcasts or watch Netflix and knit. I started doing more of like my experiments when I got older. I was not 9 when I started doing like my most fun knits, maybe. And like you can see on these two pictures, these are one of my like first projects. The one on the left is actually machine knitted. I also studied the knitting machine, like a domestic knitting machine. And that one is like knitted out of Icelandic wool, and on it I embroidered some body parts and hairs. It was for a rap duo that is based in Reykjavik, and they had a song about the beauty of the wool of the body, and the pair of sweaters came out of that. And then on the right you can see a sweater is from my like first like creative knitting project I did in 2012, where I made like 3 sweaters that were all kind of like interactive, and like they changed after how your body moved. And that is kind of the beginning of where I started with my more like performative way of how the sweater form is. For some reason, I have always gotten attached to sweaters. I think it's because like how the arms move with the body. So there's like so many different ways of like, yeah, how you can kind of like change the art piece and like move it, and it, yeah, changes its expressions and its feelings in a way. Another sweater I made some years back is the stone coat. It's also a piece where you can kind of like, yeah, it's a performative piece where you can either be wearing it as a regular coat. It's also made of Icelandic wool. And then you can turn yourself into a rock and hide whenever you want to. So these were like, yeah, one of my like first projects before like I went to uni and studied more of textile design. So I was already kind of established as a textile artist and designer in Iceland before I started studying. And looking back at these experiments is really fun, because I can see I was like experimenting a bit more, because I didn't know what I was doing in a way. So these projects are really important to me, and I feel like they are also the beginning of everything else that I have made ever since, in a way. In 2016, I made my last sweater line from scratch. It's called Zwarte Story, and it's all machine knitted with like secondhand wool that I found in secondhand stores. And I knitted 11 sweaters from scratch, and when they were all put together, they told like a story about two sweaters that met. And I showed that in like a little like grassroots art space here in Reykjavik. And that, yeah, the point of the story they were saying was kind of how we have more than enough of sweaters in the world, and how maybe don't need more. So after that exhibition, I have not really made a sweater from scratch. I've only been using secondhand sweaters that I use as a base, like kind of like canvas that I then do my art on. Like you can see on these sweaters, it's not necessarily the base that is most important about them. It's more like what I'm adding onto them. So since 2016, I've only been using secondhand sweaters that I get from like Goodwill stores or like thrift in places. And yeah, here you can see some of the upcycled sweaters, as I call them. They are always kind of, yeah, performative in a way. And I do them also like to question like our conceptions of sweaters. So they all turn into this kind of like little monsters in a way that have like feelings and personality. And I feel like that is kind of a way to also make them more special, because all of these sweaters were sweaters someone owned and like gave away. So they do need like their new character and a new face to be loved again and turned into something more special. And after I started only working with secondhand sweaters, I did a little, I participated in an exhibition in Reykjavik where they were showing only design that was upcycled or like remade with secondhand material. And I made these three sweaters for that exhibition. And I feel like they also kind of like show, yeah, what really present what I am about before and also today. You can see the cactus sweater that is out, and yeah, it's like out, hurt, like it stings. So you can like hide in it and like turn yourself into a cactus to make people like leave you alone, and also to hide in a way similar to the stone cult. And in the middle is the portal sweater. It's like a mix of like machine knitted pieces and hand embroidered and hand knitted pieces. And it has my hand on the left and all the tattoos of my hand. And it's kind of like, how to be in a, like, maybe when you feel like you're always in the wrong place in a way. That was what this sweater was about. And then the third one is called Ást, which means love in English. It's an Icelandic word. And there you can see the 3D knitted tongues that you also have seen on the face masks that are the face mask that is at the exhibition now. And this is like the first time I did this kind of like tongues on my pieces, and they became like instantly very popular. And I have been working a lot with them since, because they're something like they're both so like funny at the same time as they are very rude and a bit vulgar. There are like, yeah, so many layers of like how I want to use them, and also like the three-dimensional element of the sweater, because it's on like the sleeve, so it also like moves really nicely in a way. And yeah, on the face masks, I made in 2020, like you could probably guess. I started making them when I was actually finishing a really big project. I had like been collaborating with the Red Cross of Iceland, getting only sweaters that had like holes or stains in them and they couldn't sell in their secondhand stores. And I had been like for months working on this like big project, and we had like started to plan like this big fashion show performance with all the sweaters, and everything was like on the plan, and it was made for Design March. This is set in March, and I think it was canceled like 10 days before it was supposed to happen. So it was a quick change of days where I was like preparing for a big exhibition or like a show that I've been planning for months, and all of a sudden I was just stuck in a new studio, not really knowing what to do with this extra time. Like time kind of stopped in a way, like we all kind of probably experienced. You couldn't go out and couldn't do things, and you also like at the beginning of college, you didn't really know what was going on at all. So I decided rather than doing nothing to try to use my time and at least doing something, like something that I didn't have any plan for, which was also a nice change because at that point I had mostly been making things for like planned exhibitions or collaborations or some kind of projects. But when COVID happened, I didn't really have anything set to happen. It didn't matter if you tried to plan anything. So I decided to use the first days in my new studio, working from a sweater I made in 2019. The sweater I call the Sketch sweater. And it's a sweater I thrifted in New York when I was staying at the textile art residency there. And I used it in a way like a sketchbook. It was kind of like me trying to bring out the point of like it's always like expected for textile designers or like fashion designers to like sketch this pen and paper before doing things. Well, like I'm not necessarily a good illustrator with a pen and a paper, and the textile can be a way of sketching too. So this sweater, I did a lot of little like samples of things I wanted to try out to use in like other projects. And it was also really good for, I had like my first workshop ever when I was in New York. So it was really good to like show participants like what you can do with changing old sweaters. And this sweater was like, yeah, very dear to me. And I wanted to keep on experimenting with this concept of like sketching with just knitting needles and yarn, no pen and paper. So at the studio in 2020, I started doing these kind of different kind of face masks, because of course we had this new necessary accessory we had to wear every day, and at the same time as it was kind of a scary time, it was also a time to maybe try to lighten the mood a little bit. So I just started doing these, I consider them being like sketches or like experiments. And it was mostly just to kill time and just have something on my knitting needles. And then the plan was to just hang up the little like masks in my new studio because I had a lot of empty walls. But then, excuse me, I'm gonna have a sip of water. The masks became a big hit because at the same time as I finished the mask, I took a photo of it, usually just of myself on my phone, and shared it on Instagram, where it like became way more popular than I had ever thought it would be, because it was such a like, a little like doodle project. So I was not expecting the reactions, because of course everyone was stuck by their phone at this point. And first plan was to start making the tongues on the masks, like I had been working with earlier. But somehow in the first four masks, I didn't like find the nice way to use the tongue element on the mask. But in the fifth experiment, I made the first mask with a tongue on it. And the inspiration came from how like lizards clean their eyes and like giraffe cleans their ears with their tongues, like you can see on this mask that is now part of your collection. This was the first mask that had tongue of it. In the end, I had eight masks that were like in this phase of doing these experiments. The next one was inspired by the cold meter room. Oh yeah, I'm sorry. This one was also inspired by how you had to constantly be staying clean. All of a sudden you had to clean your hands constantly, and it was like kind of like an approach from like staying clean. So it's cleaning the eyes with the tongue. It's still like not sanitary or good if you think just about the piece and how it functions. But that's also what I was not thinking about, was the functionality of it. It was mostly just for laughs and just experimenting with the form of then like putting my formerness in the face. So of course made a lot of sense because I have been working a lot with characters and expressions. So if you put it on their face, it is can be interesting. And then this one I call Stay Away, and it was and there I went into like I want to go to a scary direction, because the point was also to make everyone stay 2 meters away from you. You couldn't go close to anyone. So this one was just meant to be scary and not like welcoming, so you would just get your space. And they touched the museum in the Netherlands bought this one for their permanent collection, and they also bought the sketch shelter that I showed earlier. And then this one was also just meant to be scary. It was a split tongue. Like you can see, I was also just experimenting with what I could do with the tongue form. Like this is kind of just disgusting in a way. You don't really know what will happen when you're sketching things. I never really knew how they would look until like I had kind of just ended them and put them on my face. I'm not sure, like the inspiration for this one was probably from the snakes that have the two ends on their tongues. And the Tate Textile Library in New York bought this mask for their collection. And then the last mask in the series I made, it was all made in March and April, all these masks of 2020. And the last one was the one that took the longest. It's called Mother Tongue. And like you can see, the concept is the big tongue that is like growing little mouths and tongues coming out of it. And it had a lot of like little detailed work. And actually, I ruined my hands a little bit making this one, and I couldn't knit for weeks after doing that one. And that also ended up being the last one of the series of the experiments I did at that point. And this mask is now in the collection in Hamburg, but it's also going up for a show soon. And then I did add one extra mask by end of the year, because I had this like idea while I was doing the masks, but my hands got too used. So I did this one as like ending 2020, and then I mixed the like prices of the first mask that I did and the Stay Away mask, and did this kind of like braces edition of Stay Away. And it was, and now it is part of National Museum of Scotland permanent collection, and it's also going up for an exhibition there quite soon, I think. You can see that like this little plan or like a play I did for myself of doing the masks went really far. All of a sudden I have like pieces all over in museum collections, and also like I got a lot of publicity while this was all going on. Vogue called, and it was kind of a crazy time in my life and everyone's life, because also COVID was on full force at these moments. After the presentation you can ask more questions about the masks. There are probably other things that I'm not covering right now about the masks. But I just want to share like an after thing that happened also with the masks, because I was really strict on just making one of each and not like sell them to not like make many of them. They were just considered as being like one of a kind sculptures. I also encourage people to just make their own. And the year before the mask adventure, I had published a little pattern book of the tongues that came from the sculpture I showed you earlier. And I made this kind of like really visual knitting pattern that is meant for like people that don't know the language of knitting. It's kind of meant as like a first project if you're not an experienced knitter, but it also of course works for experienced knitters. And I made this, it's called Slake Seam. And it's like, yeah, representing the tongues. It's a nice Latin word for making out. So that's where Slake comes from. And it had been like quite popular the year before. People were using it to upcycle their own old sweaters because it was my way of kind of like mass producing rather than getting a factory to do it or me sitting constantly knitting the same tongues again and again and again. It kind of like involved like people just do it themselves in a way. So that was the point of producing the pattern. So people could upcycle their old sweaters and make them into this sweater I saw on Instagram. And a lot of people did it as their first knitting project. A lot of people also got their moms or grannies to help them knitting the tongues. So it was a really like fun project. And I'm still getting pictures of outcomes from knitting. Like you can see here, there are a lot of different knitters, and you can see they're always so different. And it's been really interesting. It's kind of like when people talk about how people draw in different ways, they always have their own personal style. You can also see it in a way with knitting. Like none of them look the same, even though they're all going from the same pattern. This was also really interesting. But after the masks, of course, people started using the pattern to make their own face masks with tongues on them. So that was also a really interesting thing, yeah, because people were also talking about they were locked inside, they didn't have anything like planned anymore. So a lot of people took up knitting, and that's where I got also a lot of messages. It was like their first knitting project, and they were so happy to find this like activity to have while they were in quarantine in COVID. So yeah, these are just like, this picture is just like part of all the things I've been getting sent of like results from Slake Sign, or like, yeah, they market Slake Make, there you can find more photos. And I also wanted to share this quote. Someone just sent me a screenshot of a lady on Facebook. I don't know in which group it's from or who wrote it, but there's just such a nice little quote in there where she's talking about how she made this. Maybe I'll just read it. However, being a knitter doing a shelter at home order in the midst of pandemic, I could not resist the whimsical Slake recipe from Irrari and to try knitting the mouth and putting it on a mask. The mask pattern was a great way to practice short rows. Whether I will actually go out in public wearing my mask remains to be seen. Sometimes knitters just like to play around with their stuff when we are stuck at home. And then she thinks the healthcare workers. But I really connect with just yeah, being a knitter and you just want to play with your stash. It's basically where I was at when I made my masks in a way. And also people have been asking me a lot if I wore the mask in public at all. And I have only worn them on like really special occasions. Mostly it's like there was going to be a photo shoot or something involved. Like I have not gone to the supermarket wearing any of those masks. A thing to share, I barely wear my own designs myself, so but I hope the people that knitted their own tongues wore their tongue masks to the supermarket. And yeah, that's kind of the end for the masks for now, but I hope you have some questions about them. I'll just like share with you softly like what I've done since and what I'm up to right now. But in 2020, I was working on the project called Sweater Sauce, and that was what I had started doing when COVID hit and the mask happened. The project Sweater Sauce is a collaboration with the clothing gathering of the Red Cross of Iceland, and they have gathered to me in like special bags the kind of sweaters they don't put in their stores. They just send it away to like the Netherlands or Germany, like they don't really know what happens to them, so they're basically could just be ending in a landfill, we don't know. So I'm getting these sweaters that were on the way there, and I take them and change them into my own sweaters. So it's the most like sustainable kind of way to upcycle sweaters is taking the sweaters that are kind of on the way to the press. And you can see here on the picture some of the outcomes, but the name in Icelandic is peysa með öllu, which means hot dog with everything, which is like a really common snack or like a food in Iceland is the hot dog with everything, like with all the types of sauces and onion on it. It's kind of like a traditional kind of food that you eat at like end of school year and parties at grills in the summer when you're partying. It's like everyone eats it. And we could see on the sweaters we got from the Red Cross that they often had like stains on the front of the sweater because someone had been eating a hot dog and spilled it all over themselves. Like you can see on the picture with the white background, there I embroidered into the sauce stains that were like completely stuck on the sweaters because if you don't clean the sweater after you're spilling sauce on it soon and just put it in the closet, it's just gonna like really stick on it. So on that one, I like I kind of collaborated with the former owner of the sweater and embroidered into the stains, and it became like the theme of the show. Even though like not all the sweaters had this flaw on them, it was like a fun theme because everyone knows hot dogs and they're fun and festive, and it was a good theme. And in the summer, we had like we managed to do a fashion show that was supposed to happen in March, and the project got nominated for the Icelandic Design Awards for 2020. It was a great honor and really fun to get a bit more approval from the design community. And I have evolved this project now at the Design Museum in Iceland. Because I have been getting so many sweaters from the Red Cross, I won't be able to fix all of them myself. So I got like a community more involved with doing more like community-based like workshops, where like I had an open studio downstairs where I shared with people like what techniques I use and like allowed them to copy me as much as they wanted, and but also encouraged them to just go with their own style of mending the sweaters, so they could either adopt a Red Cross sweater from me. There was like a little ticket with like an agreement they had to like try it on and promise to take care of it and mend it. And then they could be adopted and they could use the workshops to mend the sweaters, or they could just bring their own sweaters that were in need of mending. And it was kind of like a really nice like area where people, like it was a 3-hour workshop every time and I had 7 of them. And just like where people, like it was so interesting how many like different kinds of people came to the workshop, and it was always like great conversations, and really like it was a really nice experiment from like me being a designer always working alone, and then like after spending months alone knitting, selling it for like a lot of money, this is like a very more interesting approach I feel to like produce things, is to also like have a teaching approach and just sharing like my, like that's more also sustainable, to just share what I have learned and the easiest ways of doing things with people rather than just me showing off what I did and you can buy it. So it has been like a great journey that I'm still on and will keep on having my workshops. I've already had some workshops after my design museum stay. And that is part of my master's program, like final project is just like looking at the ways I as a designer or teacher can like evolve like visible mending and like creative mending into clothes that make them more personal and more valuable for people. So yeah, then I have like a lot of my things now appearing in museums. So like the last one now, it was in Reykjavik Art Museum, like group show with Arrow paintings, and I had 2 of my sweaters there. So it's also really interesting to see how my sweaters are both like people are connecting with it in the design community as well as the art community, and this kind of like breaking the lines between art and design, because I'm all so focused on the material that I use, and then at the same time the like outcome is very artistic and not maybe in the aesthetics of designing. I think I didn't have any timer on for me. I hope I didn't speak too long or too fast. So the presentation is over.